Hey everyone, it's a brain in a vat again. How is everyone doing this evening? I hope you can hear me. Give me a one if you can hear me. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Hi VP, hi QWERTY. Hi Britskrieg, hi Dazed and Confused, Ivy Me, Veritas, Karen. Good, good. Okay. Everything working well. I think we'll probably take a few more minutes just in case anybody jumps in late. Hope everyone's doing well this evening. I hope you all have nice plans for Christmas and for the holidays and hopefully for New Year's. I will again, sad admin, will be alone with my cats this year because of all the chaos in the world. Hello to everyone. Maybe I missed just me and Barbara Nass, DJ Cook, hello. Is your vat leaking? No, I actually got a fresh batch of cerebrospinal fluid just for this show. So hopefully I'm fully, what's the correct verb here? I'm liquefied, I'm marinated. Well, hi Blanche, nice to see you. I'm gonna have to get you up here one of these days, Blanche, so we can talk about the dog world. Blanche is our resident social worker and dog expert. She's extremely knowledgeable about the dog world, and I find a lot of parallels between the dog community and the infighting and the true crime community on YouTube. Hello, Bo. Welcome. Fresh cerebrospinal spinal fluid. Absolutely. I mean, who doesn't need a tune-up from time to time, right? Merry Christmas, Leave It to Beaver. Thank you to you and yours as well. So, where is Laplace's demon? Why aren't you commenting? I hope you didn't fall asleep. She's in Greece, ladies and gentlemen, so the time difference is, I don't know, 6 months into our future or something. I believe she's in the year 2023 already or something. I don't know. I can never remember the time differences. And I lived in Europe for 17 years, so I really have no excuse. Uh-oh, my guest has fallen asleep. Somebody throw a wrench at my guest. Well, I mean, it sounds so mean, but I'm assuming these are sort of like Nerf wrenches. I mean, you know, they don't really hurt. Hey, Kaden, welcome everyone. Dog breeding and doxing. Well, of course, I mean, everyone is the Benny. We already know that. How is my volume, by the way? Is it, how's the sound? Is it clear? Is it staticky? Is it loud enough? Too loud? Uh-oh, here comes my cat. She can't be anywhere anymore except on my lap. Good evening, Jackie. Sounds good for me. Sound is good. Good volume. Perfecto. Clear. Claro. Okay, you sound fine. Okay, good. Okay, I think then we shall get started. Hello, TJ. Edie, good evening. Thank you for showing up. Ooh, good morning from Australia. I have not been to Australia. I my joke is always, well, it's not my joke. Reality. I'm missing two continents. So I have not been to Australia and I have not been to Antarctica. But I mean, come on, who has been to Antarctica? I mean, I would be very surprised if there was anyone in this room or anyone that any of you knows that has actually been to Antarctica. But I'd love to be proven wrong on that. I actually do have one friend who has been to Antarctica. So I haven't been to Australia, but I got close. I was in Bali, one of the most amazing experiences of my life. And I was in Hong Kong, I'd love to go to India. I think that's one on my bucket list. I'd even like to go to Cambodia and see the Angkor Wat and I forget the other temple system in Cambodia, but the ancient Khmer culture. I love ruins. I wanted to be a archaeologist when I was a kid. Those images of Indiana Jones on adventure and digging up ancient artifacts sounds so cool. Kailua, Hawaii. We used to have a little house, a plantation home in Kauai, and I spent all of my summers there for a long time. About, I don't know, 13, 15 years when I was at a great time in my life. I was a young teen and into my early 20s, and you can bet that everyone wanted to be my friend at the end of the semester before summer, because if they were just nice enough to me, they might get an invite to Hawaii. And we always had great times there. I really miss it. I wish we'd never sold that home. Hawaii is really my sort of paradise on earth. Our topic tonight is going to be the introduction of my partner and co-admin and best friend, Dr. T, aka Laplace's demon, to my brain in a vat. And she's a doctor, and so we're going to talk about medicine, going to talk about things like the ethics of medicine, and a bit of probably a logic and critical thinking and philosophy of science. So I think I shall get started. So again, hey everyone, it's the Brain of Vat again. Welcome to a new episode of the Scientific Skeptic live stream. So as I just discussed, tonight we're going to talk about medicine, philosophy of science, ethics, and who knows what else. We'll let the conversations take us where they may. And we'll share a couple videos with you. Hi, Rock Solid. One funny video, two funny videos, depending upon how you take them, and a third video, which hopefully will be a bit moving and give you a bit of insight into what it's like being a doctor. So to those of you who have followed this channel from its inception, or at least from its earlier stages, you may already know a bit about me and my background, and at this point, probably the reasons that I was drawn to YouTube in the first place. And it really reduces down to a set of ethical concerns that I had and that I continue to have about certain rather alarming and reckless behavior, even what I might call wanton exploitation, in a particular subculture that we refer to as the YouTube true crime community. And while there are certainly, it's always really important I point this out, while there are certainly many channels who handle this delicate topic of true crime stories and open investigations responsibly and even professionally and ethically and with the care and competence that such a serious topic deserves, unfortunately, there are far too many that just do not sort of live up to those standards. So a lot of the phenomena can be better explained as a sort of opportunism and very much a function of a bandwagon effect, whereby the growing appeal of true crime can be understood more as a job opportunity for some people, a potentially lucrative space where playing on our most primitive fears, our emotional susceptibilities, and even human tragedy and grief can result, in monetary compensation, an opportunity to grow one's social media presence and even popularity, a way to gain social status, a loyal following, and even for some, something like guru status. So the goal of this channel, at least at this point, is to discuss a host of topics related to a more ethical treatment and presentation of true crime, as well as educating on those areas of expertise and inquiry which tangentially and even directly relate to all of the relevant phenomena in this true crime paradigm. And because if we want to improve this community and we want to do good works and we want to actually add value and help real victims and even potentially help ongoing investigations, we have to discuss true crime not only in its social media context now, but also in a host of other areas, things like ethics, just raw competence, scientific literacy, critical thinking skills, the responsibility of YouTube itself, and even the media, and even the, unfortunately, perverted economic incentives which continue to attract people to this space and to this community. And I also hope to present information which is not only applicable to the true crime phenomena, but that you can leverage elsewhere, as many of the same problems that we're experiencing in the world today are ubiquitous. They're everywhere. And they're not only everywhere else in YouTube land, but pretty much everywhere. And this is, after all part of what I've been writing about for at least a decade now. And it relates to, you know, what we often refer to as the post-truth era. I think that was even the time word of the year a couple years ago or something. And I qualify it as a sort of runaway relativism, or my thesis, which I refer to as the revenge of the layperson. And I made even a video on it, but I definitely want to develop that thesis with you over time here. And the sort of trademark of this post-truth era is that we've essentially almost elevated opinion to the level of knowledge. And things like truth, you know, with a capital T or even a lowercase t, and facts themselves seem to be increasingly taking a back seat to just gut instinct, intuition, feelings, and subjective narratives. And, you know, I think that's a problem for a civil society. You know, you either believe in things like facts and what is true, or at least more likely to be true, or you don't. And I think that if people don't care about things like facts and a concern and pursuit for what is likely true, more probable to be true, you know, I think that's a harbinger of less than positive things. So enough with my intro. Tonight, I have a special guest with me, and we go way back, almost a decade now. And she happens to be not only my longtime partner and my best friend, but also my co-admin and contributor on my Facebook forum and my website, which we refer to as SCTS, Science, Critical Thinking, and Skepticism, and my scientificskeptic.com website. And she happens to be also the only person that I trust enough to give the keys to those vehicles, because we both share so many of the same values and intellectual interests. It's almost a bit uncanny. And what else? Oh, right. She's smarter than I am. And that's not easy for my ego to take. I like to consider myself fairly smart. And, you know, sometimes I like to think that I know a thing or two about a thing or two, and that I'm a pretty good reasoner, a decent critical thinker. But she's quicker than I am. I always need some time to synthesize information and to sort of work through it and follow it to its logical conclusion. But when I finally get there, she tends to be looking off into the distance and tapping her fingernails on the table, sort of waiting for me to catch up. So without further, wait a minute. No, Nope. Ain't gonna happen. Ain't going there. I am not completing that phrase. I promised you already in a previous video I would never use that cliche here. The most overused cliche on YouTube. So I'm not doing it. I caught myself right in time where I made that horrific mistake. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce you to Dr. T, aka Laplace's Demon, her new moniker and pseudonym. And I have to try this evening to not say her real name, you know, because, you know. Hey, Gray, nice to meet you. Oh, I'm really looking forward to speaking with you, Gray. I just had a nice talk with Trisha. Thanks for coming in. It'd be a real honor for me to chat with you. And thanks for showing up. So before we meet my guest this evening, would you guys be interested in seeing a couple of pictures of her? Throw me a one if that interests you. Did I miss some action in the chat room during my introduction? Hello, Hanlon. Okay, we got a one. Okay, let's see now if I can change my screen quickly enough. Let me find the images. 1 second, please. Okay, so Dr. T happens to be a big fan of Harry Potter. Now, he's a bit younger than me, so I grew up more to the Tolkien days and the Lord of the Rings series. But she likes Harry Potter, and this is a picture of her dressed up on Halloween. What do you think? Did she do a good job of being Harry? Dr. T, you're being quiet.
Can I make a comment?
You're being quiet. You know, I haven't introduced you formally yet.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not sure what's my segue here. Hello, everyone.
No, you don't.
Okay.
You don't get to say hello yet because I haven't introduced you formally, but you can laugh or say something silly about your pictures because I'm showing them.
Thank you.
You want to add any commentary?
I mean, I'm slaying this look is all I have to say.
Yeah, I think you did a good job. By the way, is the lightning bolt supposed to be off center? Is that the location? I figure it is, right? That was intentional.
Well, I did that on purpose. Yeah, I didn't. It wouldn't be very good if I didn't understand what off center means.
So now, you know, I don't know how I feel about this because I'm pretty sure that's a boy, right?
Yes.
So now let's see her as a woman in her more natural state.
And I'm this not is sure you. I would call that natural, but okay.
This is what? Maleficent?
Indeed.
Okay. I'm never sure how to say that correctly. This is a great one, though. There were lots of pictures of. Now that's snow in your background, right?
Not quite. It's just a white paint over rocks. It's a very common thing in Greek islands.
Because obviously in Greece, it's not very frequent that you guys get snow. Okay, so enough of that for the moment. So where was I? So back to our introduction. So good evening, Dr. T. How are you this evening? Where are you calling in from? I sort of forget.
Hello, Mr. Skeptic. I'm calling in from Athens, Greece. And it's 1:30 in the morning.
that's Georgia, right? That's in the southeast of the United States?
Definitely not.
No?
No. Yeah, it's a few thousand miles off.
a few thousand miles off. And so you, I believe, are somehow into our future. You're what, 6 months? What's the time difference? How far away
Oh,
Were you?
years, years, years and years.
Years and years into the
Yeah,
future.
we have
Okay.
flying cars over here.
Wow. Can you get me some
Yeah.
stock? Can you get me some winning stock picks or,
I can't use my powers for personal gain, sorry.
what, out of principle or because?
These are the
Oh, for Christ's sake. Come on. Be a bit immoral. Give me some of that. Give me some of that future info.
Nope.
No.
Nope.
Okay, so Dr. T, aka Laplace's demon, which we will be explaining a bit later. I think I talked about it in my other video, the sort of idea behind it and how, well, I don't want to go there yet. So why don't you tell all of us a bit? Oh, by the way, before I say anything, does anyone think that she sounds like she's not an English speaking mother tongue? Because I'm not picking up a lot of Greek accent. Is anyone else in the room sort of could easily confuse her with a native English speaker? Give me
I'm
a,
waiting here with
yeah,
bated breath.
give me a one. Give me a one if you think her accent's not bad for a foreigner. I hate this time lag. You never
Oh,
get direct
well, yeah.
feedback and you don't know what the heck's going on. He speaks better than I do as well. I actually do ask her for English words. No, I can't find the word. How do you say that in English?
Yeah, we do that a lot. The other thing is that it was funny, especially in the beginning when we were talking. There were a couple of words that were giving me trouble.
Oh,
And
what?
you remember, of course, which one. Yeah.
Sugar, sugar,
Sugar. Sugar. I just had
sugar.
so much trouble with saying sugar. It was like, sugar. It's
There have been a couple
always me.
others. There have been a couple others, haven't there? Can you think of any of the other ones?
I can't think of them right now, but I remember at some point I was watching a British series and I started to say person and
Oh, yeah.
it
Yeah, you had a British accent suddenly. A person, a
was
person. And then it got stuck and you couldn't stop doing it for weeks.
for nothing else though, it was just that word. For
See?
whatever reason, it was just the person. I don't know.
VP thinks that you speak prettier than I do. That's
Well,
probably true.
with that intro you gave me, I think you've tied their hands.
Well, I mean,
Wasn't very clear.
maybe we should, have you sing a version of "You're a Mean One, Mr. Fish," and then, have like a contest, and we can vote on it. Take a
Oh
poll,
my.
hear what a female version sounds like. Well, I did play our song, our fallacy song, the Christmas parody that we did a couple years ago. So that was
Yeah.
fun. I'm sure
A
it,
lot of fun, yeah.
it is Christmas time, so it's I don't even I'm surprised that we pulled that one off.
And it happened so quickly.
Yeah, it was and it was fun.
Really didn't put that much thought into it. It was more like, let's just go for it. It was nice.
Yeah, it was fun. We need to do that some more. So please tell everyone in the room a bit about you and your background.
Okay, so I'm Greek. We have established that. I'm a doctor. I'm about to begin my medical residency in psychiatry. And I've always loved all things science, all things cerebral, really. Just thinking about things is definitely something I've enjoyed. Deep thoughts and deep conversations, sharing experience with other people and trying to figure out, what is this thing that we're experiencing? So I
So the
think that covers it.
ontology and epistemology and was always a part of your intellectual interest.
Absolutely.
And a little bird told me that your family has a bit of a science history. Could you maybe share a bit of that with us?
You could say that. Both parents physicists, so you know that already did some damage.
Yeah, we're both damaged goods, only for different reasons.
Yeah. So, you know, common conversations, like dinner conversations, are about quantum mechanics and the nature of the universe. And this is how I was raised. So, yeah.
And so you guys, don't you guys like sit around and play brain puzzle games and thought experiments and all sorts of odd sorts of games?
Oh, yeah. First of all, we love board games in general, you know, not necessarily the very strange things, but, you know, we are definitely nerds in all the meaning of the word. And I say that with kindness and love, because I love nerdy things. I've never found that as an insult. And yeah, definitely, we love going down the rabbit hole of difficult conversations. We've never been afraid to talk about things that other people are probably, you know, scared of. So it's been strange to me interacting with other people and seeing that, oh, this isn't something that all people are used to. It's not necessarily how most people talk. But yeah, this is a norm for us.
Yeah, I mean, I grew up with an artist father and an existentialist author mother. So, you know, they all sat around and talked about Nietzsche and Dostoevsky, and my mother was reading Jean-Paul Sartre and Samuel Beckett to me as bedtime stories. So I also didn't have a typical upbringing. But
so
too
long didn't read version of this live stream is we were both doomed at a very young age.
Something like that. I don't know where that fits on the damaged goods spectrum. But one of the things you brought up, because it's always been an interesting one for me, is that because I love science and philosophy and I've been teaching them for a long time, you know, you just often immediately get associated with the nerd, the sort of stereotype of the glasses and the pocket protector. And, you know, you were sort of, you know, not, you were socially awkward as a kid and people maybe made fun of you sort of thing. And that stereotype, I mean, I think there is some truth to, you know, a lot of stereotypes actually, but I wasn't a nerd. I did not have that experience. I was athletic and I was in the drama class and had the lead role in school plays, and I was fairly well accepted. But because I was sort of not a nerd, oftentimes certain crowds, certain cliques would try to own me and sort of force me to be a member. And I've always been a bit of a loner, even though I would like to think I was always fairly socially acceptable. And, you know, I just never wanted to be owned. I was never part of a clique. And, you know, I'm sort of a loner to this day and maybe becoming a bit more of a recluse with time. But I always loved the nerds. I mean, they liked a lot of things that I liked. And I remember getting backlash and even, you know, defending nerds, and then having, you know, like the jock clique or the popular crowd or something, you know, trying to castigate me because I would be friends with, you know, somebody from the chess club or, you know, somebody that would go to lab instead of out to the, you know, the sports pitch at lunch. And, they would say things literally like, you can't be friends with us and be friends with the nerds sort of thing. And I just remember as early as I can remember saying, no, I think you've got this wrong. I don't want to be friends with you if you tell me who I can be friends with, or, you know, if you're a bully or whatever. So, you know, coming at it from an opposite side. So it's sort of interesting that we came together and, you know, that we have an affinity.
Yeah. Sorry to change the subject slightly. I just noticed that Second Fox Nanny asked which English we learn, American or British, I guess. So I wanted to answer that because I saw that in the chat room now. Initially, we were taught British English. So I still spell flavor OU and color OU. I can't spell it any other way.
And center as well.
Oh my God, center. Oh yes, I can't not spell it that way. Yeah, I'm stuck with that. But obviously, there's more exposure to American English, internet, series, movies. So inevitably, now I speak more American. Speak American to me.
I think I might have had just a bit of a...
Yeah, a little bit. A tiny bit. Yeah, for sure. But it's funny because I have some things that come out at weird moments. Also Harry Potter, because I learned a lot of English from Harry Potter, just reading them in English. So some spelling and some vocabulary and some expressions are actually from Harry Potter. So it's always funny that it's sort of a mix and match with my English. You don't know where it comes from.
Yeah, I mean, at this point now, with the odd exception of person.
It was just a phase. It was just a phase. It was barely like a month or something.
Yeah, but it was odd. It's like something got caught in your craw. You must have been watching.
Yeah, I don't know why. Just got stuck with me.
A series or something. And it was so funny. We couldn't stop laughing about it because you couldn't stop saying it that way. And then I started saying it and we laughed. And...
Yeah. So since you mentioned school, I also see a comment by Jen that she was tortured for many years. And yeah, I mean, I feel you. I don't know what to say. Bullying is just a terrible thing. And people just treat it as if it's, you know, just this force of nature that nobody can do anything about it. And of course, that's not true. It's just laziness from teachers and parents and all that stuff. I also had a terrible, terrible experience at school, especially in elementary school. And I don't know, I'm sort of really confused that teachers allow that.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think part of the problem is that until fairly recently, you know, I would argue that it just simply, it wasn't disincentivized, and there were, you know, I think to a certain extent, it was sort of promoted in a lot of our role modeling. You know, there was always a bit of, you know, the sort of machismo culture. There was a bit of the, you know, just sort of the toughness ethic, and obviously some of it comes from upbringing. So, you know, now over the last, I'd say, what, couple decades at least, now, you know, people are making noise that, you know, bullying, we really want to discredit it and hopefully, you know, thwart it, you know, in the development phase, so that, you know, people just sort of, our children don't grow up thinking that that's okay behavior, you know, and that it shouldn't ever be normalized anymore.
Yeah, exactly. But, you know, times have changed. There's been a lot of changes about social issues and kindness in society and just violence and violent behavior not being accepted anymore. So I think these are pretty new concepts, and that's a good thing. We're going to be seeing changes.
Yeah, I mean, some of these sorts of changes, these societal norms, you know, can be generational. And, you know, I think one of the problems in terms of identifying or evaluating human progress is that we evaluate it within a very short mortal lifetime. So I think we all want, you know, whatever, higher degrees of justice. We would like people to be more cooperative and treat each other with more respect. And because we have such a limited lifespan, it's very difficult to, you know, quantify progress. And unfortunately, you sort of have to look maybe over longer periods of time. Some of these things take a while to sort of, you know, get into the system and become established new norms.
Yeah. Indeed.
Back to you, Dr. T. So, tell us a bit about, you know, you obviously have a science background. You said, obviously you have two parents that were physicists, and don't you have another couple of siblings that are scientists?
Indeed, I have four siblings. We're five kids. My two brothers are both physicists, even though my one brother is more towards IT in the end, but he also studied physics. So again, the same bug in the brain. And my two sisters, my one sister is a psychologist. So again, very similar to what I'm about to do. And my other sister has taken the full artist thing. She's an actress and director. So overall, there's just a lot of scientific disciplines in there.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely.
And a lot of philosophy as well, just a lot of thinking about things, I'd say.
Yeah, I mean, you had a lot of different pathways. Let me just answer one question from Second Fox Nanny. I think the fact that I was just luckily athletic provided me with a lot of insulation and ultimately social clout that I probably would not have gotten had I not been sort of adopted by the you know, whatever you want to call it, the jock crowd, the, you know, the athlete crowd. And ultimately, when I was growing up, I think that's fairly common. The athletic crowd also tended to be the tough guy crowd and even the tough girl crowd. And so they were, unfortunately, some of the bullies, but they protected me. So basically, because I was an athlete and because they respected me simply for that ability, sort of no one messed with me. So I absolutely think that it helped me. Whether it gave me the courage, you know, I'd like to think that any courage I had to stand up for underdogs was more, you know, maybe just my natural, you know, I'm not a mean person. I'm a fairly nice person, and I don't like it when innocent people are treated poorly. And so I had to often negotiate, and as I was a kid, and, you know, I didn't want to have trouble with the people who liked me, these other athletes. You know, I had to sort of be a diplomat very early. I didn't want to alienate them, and I didn't want to get beaten up by them. So trying to, you know, intervene on the side of, you know, sort of victims of bullying against very often my friends, you know, was always delicate. And I even had a lot of negative interactions where, you know, my friends would try to push me into a fight, and I'm just not really a fighter. And it was very delicate for me. You know, I even had a bad experience where I refused to fight, and then my jock friends, you know, called me bad names. And it wasn't that I was a coward, it's that I had no problem with the individual, and I was not going to beat someone up simply because someone told me to, and I had to pay some social consequences. So thanks for, that's a good question and something sort of important. So I did, you know, recognize that it definitely provided me with you know, sort of a cushion from bullying. So I guess then back to Dr. T. So you had a few different options. You certainly had some artistic stuff in the family. You had some science stuff and philosophy. So what drew you to medicine?
That very simple, short question that requires a lot of answering.
Come on, you have a three-word maximum. Okay. You need to say it in three words. Just kidding.
Love fixing things.
That's a good one. I like that.
Not bad.
Humans are things. They're a certain sort of thing.
Yeah, I mean, I'm definitely the fixing person. Like, I see something and I have to fix it. I think part of it actually comes from that. I've always been drawn to medicine. I've always been interested in how biology works, how bodies work. And then, of course, how do you fix it when it breaks down? I always thought life was just this marvelous thing, and the idea of preserving it sounded very nice, very noble, even, I guess.
Noble.
Yeah, so I was just so drawn to it. It wasn't really a decision in that sense. It just felt like that's how it was supposed to be.
So
I don't want to
did you
get metaphysical here, but
right, so did you remember when you sort of thought that that was your calling, or do you remember having alternative professions in mind?
it is sort of a strange, way that it happened, in the sense that I didn't actually make the decision until I knew I could do it. So the actual physical decision, if I can call it that, was made when I was finishing high school and I had the grades. It was very safe. It was only after I knew I could get into med school that I actually said, I'm going to med school. I had never said to anyone that that was something I wanted to do. I had talked about becoming a vet. But I always thought, even though I was a very good student, it just felt so impossible to get those kind of grades. And it seemed like it was too early to say, I'm 10 years old. I couldn't say, yeah, in 7, 8 years, I'm going to be able to have those grades. I never felt safe enough to say that. But once I knew I could do it, it was a no-brainer. It was definitely, yeah, I'm seeing that comment there. Fear of failure. Yeah.
I mean, I almost want to intervene on your part to say, that's a really good question to ask Dr. T, and I'm pretty sure she's going to weigh in on that one.
Yeah. Oh, definitely. I've always been playing it safe in my life because I'm a perfectionist. So, I mean, I've achieved most of the things I wanted to do. But yeah, I've always been doing that. It's like I go after something once I feel I'm confident I can get it. So especially for something so big as med school, I didn't want to be in the position of telling everybody this is what I want to do and then fail and having to live with that. It was definitely just cowardice on my part of
Not
owning up to my
coward.
desires.
I mean, I want to go back to a question. I'm sort of afraid. Maybe just keep it on the burner. But there's a couple things I notice. Well, there's one thing I notice about you that I don't think I have, a certain quality. And there's also what did I want to say about it? The one is sort of the ick factor. What really stands out about me is that you don't seem to have an ick factor. And I think that's fairly uncommon. And I would think that you'd certainly need to learn and develop it to be a doctor. But I think a lot of people, have that. I mean, it's a
I
very
mean,
biological
yeah.
thing. It's part of our evolution.
And I wouldn't say I don't have it. It's actually been trained out of me to a certain extent. And still, it's like I wouldn't go for surgery. So it really depends. There are some things that I'm more comfortable than others, but it's, for sure. If you do it and you do it enough, you get used to it for sure.
I suppose like anything else.
Yeah.
So, I mean, unless you want to say anything else about sort of what drew you to medicine, or if there are any questions just about the, where we are now in the conversation, before we go a bit further, if we take a tiny break, or do you have anything else to say just on that front, where we've gone so far?
just to answer real quick, Flor Morena, I don't have a medical specialty. I'm about to begin right now, psychiatry. So yeah.
So you're a general.
This is where we are.
You're a general MD for how long now? 3 years?
Four, yeah.
And when you were on the island, when you began, that was a, what was the setting again? Was it a hospital? Was it an ER?
Oh yeah. So first of all, because I don't think this is the same system as in the US, in Greece, we have a mandatory 1 year rural medical service thing. So basically, it's to cover the needs of health centers on islands and, you know, on small villages and on mountains and things like that. And you serve there for a year. And it's mandatory. And it happens before we do, before we start our medical specialty.
And do you have to do sort of ER work in that context?
It's basically GP work.
Okay.
And that includes emergency work as well, by definition.
I mean, I know that, you know, you've lost some people, right?
I broke some sternums. It's what I usually say, because that sort of sound stays with you when you do a CPR, for sure. So yeah, those were quite strong memories. I don't want to do ER anymore. It's true. I think I've had my share.
BP asked about psychiatry. We sort of want to cover that at the end, but we'll definitely be getting back to that one. I mean, you know, the other thing just that, you know, just screams out, you know, if you know, you can sort of use the metaphor of a doctor as being, you know, the equivalent of a car mechanic for a body, for a human organism. And I think that to a certain extent, I think you have to find a certain detachment just to survive sort of mentally, you know, being a doctor. But I mean, you know, I think it's important, the recognition that we all need to have that, you know, a bad decision here or there, a bad day, you know, is the difference between a car mechanic, you know, badly repairing a car, or, you know, making a mistake and, you know, a car doesn't start or needs to be brought back to the garage in a week, and a dead person. I mean, you know, someone's life being lost. I mean, so the consequences, the costs are so yeah. high for mistakes. So, you know, how do you sort of feel like you manage that, you know, pressure?
Not very well, is the honest answer. It's a work in progress. I'm not really sure how to answer that question. What I can say is that in all of those life and death situations, when I found myself in these situations where I had a person that either died in front of me or almost died in front of me, there's something really surreal about the experience. You're looking at that body of the person and you're going like, there's something really wrong going on. And there's something very inherent about this experience. You just really starting to process that moment differently. And I'm sure it's because of the adrenaline and the stress and all those things. So all of those moments have sort of a dreamlike feel after the fact.
And I imagine something like that time slowing down paradox phenomenon.
Sort of, yeah, like being trapped in that moment, like an eternity of a moment kind of a thing. And definitely your mind going way, way, way faster. Just thinking about all those things that need to happen and all of those choices, all of those decisions that need to be made. These are definitely
interesting
experiences.
Sort of as part of med school, I imagine there's a certain amount of people that are, you know, at least in the early phases, you know, maybe not up to the task, and you know, maybe run out and you know, get sick or stop, give up. You know, I mean, I suppose some of that can be learned and you get used to it. But what was your experience in med school with your peers and colleagues? Was there some sort of known percentage of people that just once they get into the real stuff, they can't hack it?
Well, I mean, for sure it isn't for everybody, but also a lot of people can actually go, you know, do a lot in medicine without getting to these experiences. So these experiences aren't necessarily what they're going to make you drop med school, because it's not very common for you to have people, to lose people. It's not something that happens very commonly. But for sure, for some people, that stress is just going to be too much. And what I can say is that the system of medical training universally sucks. There's something really weird about it, but the support just isn't there. You're taking these very vulnerable young people, and for whatever reason, and this is quite universal, it's very interesting, there's a convergence going on, but you know, globally the sense is just throw.
Sorry, I just hit the wrong flip and mute button myself. Can you repeat the last two words? Sorry about that.
So basically, you know, the sense is that you throw them in the water and whoever survives, survives. And there's a whole, you know, philosophy, almost cult-like thing going on that everybody then supports the system. This is how it should be, because if you're not tough enough to survive, then you shouldn't be doing it. And I find this very strange because, you know, it's like nobody's going to tell you, oh, you're a runner. What you're going to do the first day we're training you is run till, you know, you hurt your legs and then you have to stay in bed for the next 3 months. You know, no training thing will tell you overextend so much that then you need months and months to recover or that you just can't do it. It's all about building your strength from the point you are.
Yeah, I mean, you know.
Is a very strange thing.
Well, one of the things, you know, because medicine, you know, is essentially treated like any other formation, any other training, you know, we understand now that humans are not necessarily equipped to deal with the sort of psychological and emotional, you know, consequences of not only the formation, but just life in general. You know, we're sort of trying to bring that on board. But I mean, at the end of the day, it's like everyone should have, you know, mental health expertise. You know, I mean, if you're a manager or if you're, you know, training people to be a doctor, you know, how to deal with the stress and the anxiety and how to, you know, deal with just the sort of normal ups and downs that we all have in life. And so, you know, I mean, that's a problem in so many areas today. And like, for example, we're talking to a true crime community and we recognize that, you know, whether it's an interrogation or it's how police deal with, you know, just people on the street, especially those that might be having some sort of mental episode, they're certainly not trained to know how to handle those situations. They're cops or they're, you know, investigators. So, you know, I suppose that the same phenomenon is in medicine, wouldn't you think?
Yeah. And by the way, it's interesting because now you brought up cops and I was thinking about that earlier when we were talking before beginning the live stream, that there's something about, you know, military, police force, and the medical field, there's something similar, which is that sense of, you know, just, want to say torture, but sort of the hazing aspect, you know, the aspect of we're going to push you to the breaking point, and you just have to take it and prove that you can survive it. And there's something similar about those fields in that sense. And it's considered a must. Like, there is no other way. And, like, this is the way it should be. And I can't speak for military training because this isn't at all, my specialty. But when it comes to medicine, it makes no sense to me whatsoever. And the evidence doesn't bear it in any way, so.
Yeah, I'm sure you might want to answer the question on screen from Jen. And thank you, Graz. Graz just said something really nice. So informative. Thank you both for today. This is great. Thank you. That's kind. I hope you find it useful and informative.
Before
I forget, and this is all about me, Janice, it's all about me for a second. I have terrible graphic skills, but when we decided we were going to adopt the Laplace's demon logo for Dr. T, she went out immediately looking for dragons because that was just obvious. And so she found a screenshot, and I struggled last night trying to make a silly logo, and I tried to change the colors. And so what do you guys think? Do you guys like the logo I made? And but more importantly, Dr. T, have I done it justice?
I like it.
Okay, do you guys
I
like
do. It's purple.
Give us a one. Exactly. It's purple, right? Prince would be proud. So give us a one if you like her logo.
Purple dragon. Yeah. Oh, by the way, we've done this all wrong. When I introduced myself, I should have said, I love purple, cats, and chocolate. I don't know why I didn't do it like that.
Right. I totally accept that I'm way down the list. I accept taking a backseat to both chocolate and cats. I don't know how I feel about dragons, but I certainly accept taking a backseat to cats. So maybe you want to answer Jen's question? So, that looks like a good one, right?
I mean, yeah, just work-life balance at its best. I mean, I'm not going to lie, it's not easy, and it's definitely, again, a work in progress. I think I've definitely been doing better. The first year I worked as a doctor, there was no general life. I'm not going to lie, I was just surviving. I was just going to work and using all my energy there. And then the rest of the day, I was just a zombie moving from one place to another and just eating and sleeping, and that's it. It took a while, and it's sort of like to learn to trust your abilities so that then you can accept you did the best you can and not spend energy after going home just second-guessing every single thing you did. That sort of compartmentalization, that's hard work. That's a hard word.
You pulled it off. That was.
Did I? I think I did, yeah.
Like a boss.
Sort of. I messed it up after. But yeah, that's sort of the thing that you need to do. Trust yourself. Do the best you can. Be present when you're doing it, and then close the door and go home and be the rest of yourself. But of course, all those things are just so nice and easy. Very
easy to say, necessarily to accomplish. Yeah. So I think
I wanted to answer a question somebody asked. It's been a while now. Somebody asked if I've delivered babies, and I haven't. I've been present for some deliveries, and I was actually present at the delivery of my nephew because my sister wanted me in. So I actually saw my nephew being born, which was a very nice experience, I have to say. Yeah, but I haven't actually helped deliver babies.
I'm
somebody else. Sorry,
I'm pretty sure, I'm pretty sure I would pass out in the ground.
I mean, I don't know if I want to say this, but I mean, most men have a little bit of a problem with that. I don't know why. Maybe we're just
I don't know how I
the whole blood and stuff.
I don't know how I feel about that. I mean, I suppose I resent that that correct representation. I don't know. Do you want to touch this one?
Yeah, I saw that too. I also wanted to answer a previous question, which was about what we're talking about, the police force and things like that. Luna asked, do you agree that the police and other agencies need more training in mental health? And this is a no-brainer. Yes. Very simply, yes. For sure. I don't think it needs much more elaboration.
I'm going to take a one-minute break, so go ahead and keep talking. I'll be right back.
Okay. So the question by Kay Dunn, the COVID patients, were you involved with COVID patients in Greece, and what kind of toll did that take on you? So when the COVID crisis began, I was actually working at a diagnostic center, so I wasn't... At the front seat of the whole thing. I was quite sheltered in that sense. But still, just seeing those kind of cases of people, especially when they were really young people, and they would often come to us and they would be in a very, you know, in a good state. They didn't seem that... They seemed quite fine. And then we would get that CT scan and their lungs would be in a terrible condition. And it was just so sad and scary because we knew that they had months and months of rehabilitation ahead of them, provided that they actually managed to get over the particular infection at that time. So... just the whole situation was very stressful. Watching what it could do to families, and especially that process of just people coming in and saying, you know, I gave it to my father, I gave it to my mother, we lost our grandmother, and just this whole process of just, yeah, infectious diseases are just a very particular thing. So, it was quite scary to finally experience a pandemic of that scale because, of course, a lot of doctors, you know, we talk about it, but we hadn't experienced it. And our generation, well, now we have that under our belt, I guess. It's one way to say it. Now that I'll be at a hospital, it's going to be a bit different.
It's almost like this only happens once in 100 years and people don't really understand how to deal with pandemic.
Yeah, exactly.
Despite the fact that they're fairly ubiquitous across time.
Yeah.
So, okay. So, well, thank you again, Dr. T. It's so funny to call you Dr. T. I have to say it like theatrical every time, Dr. T.
Dr. T.
like you're a character from a Bond movie or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it does make me sound like a villain.
Yeah, I've never used that. I've never called you that ever. Well, I mean, I suppose we've sort of joked about it, but at least using your whole name. So the next question I have for you is to maybe talk about your prep for becoming a doctor. I guess my question is, you know, you sound like you know, whatever, you think you know a thing or two about the body and about medicine and treating people for, you know, deadly diseases and how to save them from dying. I mean, you know, this is the implicit claims you're making. So why can't I, you know, I mean, it seems to me that I should just be able to go on Google for, I don't know, 15, 20 minutes, do a bit of my own research, and I'm pretty sure I could know what you know.
Oh, totally, and you'll be convinced that you're dying of brain cancer. So, you know, you should be aware of that.
So, I mean, what are you claiming that, I couldn't set a broken leg with, just a quick Google search or, like remove someone's brain tumor with my Swiss Army knife successfully and not kill them if I just, do a bit of homework?
Well, you caveated it. You said without killing them, because I was about to say, well, maybe you can take out the tumor. I'm not convinced you can keep them alive, but you can do a punch.
I bet I could kill the tumor.
I mean, yeah, that reminds me the XKCD comic of, a handgun can kill tumor cells in a petri dish. However,
Oh,
that's
right,
the joke goes.
the in vitro in vivo
Yeah.
conversation.
Yeah,
Yeah.
exactly.
So I was going to ask you about the just long, arduous process of becoming a doctor and maybe the challenges again, and what it taught you, maybe even about yourself, and how you sort of felt when you got to the top of the mountain. And I believe that you wanted me to maybe
I
exemplify
think
that.
there's a song for that. Yeah, there's a parody song, but I think it covers it.
Okay, well let's take a
Yeah.
look at that then. Hopefully my videos now have audio correctly. So here's a little bit of entertainment.
The fourth cold light in the MICU tonight, not a fellow to be seen. This patient's in isolation and his sputum's kinda green. His pulse is bounding like there's something wrong inside. Couldn't name it though, heaven knows I tried. Don't let them in, don't let them see how I look up this stuff on WebMD. It's time to round my panic groans. Oh God, this blows. I don't know, can't hold it back anymore. I don't know, get me up and off this floor. I don't care what they're going to say. Let the bad grades come. I want to do psychiatry anyway. Funny how my attending makes everyone feel small when he asks these crazy questions, but the gunner knows them all. It's time to see what I can do. Place this NG tube, don't break through. They ask me how this chest is viewed. I'm screwed. I don't know. When I present my plan, they all look to the ground. My feet are killing me. Who knew it took 10 years to round? And one thought forms inside with perfect clarity. The past 2 years did not prepare me for M3. I don't know, and I rise at the break of dawn. I don't know, my social life is gone. Say goodbye. to the woods. I'd take it over second year any day.
This is just too good. This is just too good. And I just feel like saying, I feel personally attacked by these relatable content, because she even says at some point, I want to do psychiatry anyway, which I think is hilarious.
And very applicable.
Exactly.
So yeah.
Does that answer your question?
So well done. I mean, I even I found it moving.
Yeah, I mean, it is. Plus,
she's
for sure.
Talented, but I mean, what a voice! But I mean, I imagine it's sort of a bit of an inside joke that might only truly. I mean, you can appreciate the talent, but also just I think it's a bit of an inside joke in terms of some of the terminology, probably better appreciated by med students.
Yeah. It's all very well thought out.
Yeah. I think we sort of covered some things. You know, I wanted to ask you sort of again, you know, what does it feel like to be a doctor? How does being a doctor differ from the ride, you know, the long, arduous process, and, you know, how you felt when you were done, how you felt when you were in the midst of it. You know, and then I also just wanted to ask you sort of, how would you enunciate your sort of values as a doctor? And do you find those ubiquitous among doctors?
Yeah, so they're kind of
a lot of
two separate elements. Yeah, there. I mean, I did not like my medical education at all. It's not a secret. Whenever we've had this conversation, I've never said anything different. I prefer being a doctor than what was being trained. And for sure, I was actually thinking about it. When I first started my clinical training, it was literally, I think, the first day, and my team was assigned to the ICU. And this doctor who was supposed to be there to teach us, there was this woman, she was under sedation, and I don't remember what exactly it was that he said he wanted to show us, but he very theatrically just uncovered her, and she was completely naked under the covers. She had a catheter, she had a lot of tubes, she was intubated, and it was a very shocking thing to see when you haven't seen it before. And it was so evident that he was getting his kicks out of shocking us. You know, we're whatever, 19 year olds, I think.
At the expense of the dignity of a human being.
Exactly. And it was just, and that was literally one of my first experiences at a clinic. And this just just explains perfectly my problem with medical education, with the fact that most people who are engaged in medical education do not have the sensitivity, the proper sensitivity, the proper respect. Exactly. It was just terrible. And the worst part was that they treat us as if, oh, you know, if you have a problem with that, or if you said something about it, that you're being overly sensitive, so you're not good enough to be a doctor. Which I find so, I don't even know what word to use here. Just infuriating is a good word.
Yeah, immoral.
Immoral, for sure. So I've had this fight throughout my entire medical education, because this whole process was just going so much against my ethics, basically, to mention then the ethics of it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm going to put this one up because I know you and I have talked about it. And there's a, you know, I mean, as part of this sort of post-truth era, you know, something that we've been talking about for a long time on our Science and Philosophy Forum, you know, because we're going through a period where there's so much just expertise resentment, anti-institution resentment, you know, that I think ultimately we've gone too far on that front, and I think it's very problematic. At the same time, you know, we can't ignore, if we're being honest, that, you know, there aren't some legitimate grievances to discuss. And, you know, it's a very delicate topic because there are already so many people, you know, who are either afraid of doctors or don't think some doctors are sensitive enough. And I know that you have a position on that. And, you know, I mean, I think you're really well equipped to sort of address that topic.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's just a very important conversation, and I don't know, for whatever reason, it's just not very evolved yet. Like I said, I don't know, there's something about medicine, the experience is very global. Like, for example, the video we just played, people from all over the world, from so many different countries, they have the same experience. It's very strange, really. I'm not sure why.
Well, and I think, you know, an important point is that, you know, I mean, doctors are humans. You know, all humans are fallible. Not all humans have great, you know, social skills. You know, for some, it's very much a job. They have their, you know, own problems outside. We need to be a bit respectful of the pressure they're under. At the same time, you know, we do, because of the nature of the profession, you know, we talk about sort of it being a prerequisite to have what's called bedside manner. And, you know, in some cases, it's less than stellar or up to a, you know, a reasonable standard on the part of some. But, you know, I mean, like, I suppose sort of a million-dollar question is, as a doctor, you know, how do you feel about promoting your profession, you know, and how do you address these sorts of issues without making people, you know, sort of afraid or antagonistic or concerned that they don't have the competence?
Yeah. Well, I think the easy answer is that still a doctor, any doctor really, is going to be in a better position to treat your medical issues than any random person on the internet or, you know, off the street. And if this sounds like a low bar, it is, but at the same time, it sort of clears the view because it makes it obvious that if you have a medical problem, you need to find a physician to help you with it.
Better an annoying, obnoxious doctor than like the pizza delivery guy when it comes to like serious medical conditions.
Yeah.
And exactly. nothing nothing against pizza delivery boys.
Yeah, absolutely. Exactly. So that sort of clears the fog, I think. But that doesn't mean that there isn't a lot of room for improvement and that we should be trying to keep getting better.
And that, again, you know, a lot of this then becomes, you know, ethics. And again, we can talk about this everywhere. We can talk about it in the true crime community. It's sort of, there's a level of professionalism which can always be elevated and some fall short. And, you know, we can then, you know, promote those hopefully with the best of values and behavior and, you know, possibly take those to task that don't live up to the standards. And it's a big, you know, problem across the board. You know, I worked in the corporate world and, you know, we incentivize a lot of bad behavior and how to change the norms, you know, is a really difficult question to evaluate in terms of how to improve things.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Okay, so I wanted to, I've always been, you know, fascinated with medical ethics, the topical of medical ethics, and, you know, even sort of the Hippocratic Oath as being sort of the fundamental ethic of any doctor. And this goes back, I'm pretty sure, to an ancient Greek guy who probably had a similar name. That doesn't, that doesn't sound like an Italian guy, since I'm half Italian. The topic is just so vast, and it's so consequential for our species that, you know, that we get these things right in terms of, you know, experimentation ethics and how we treat animals and sort of, you know, the protocols that you as doctors have with your patients, you know, in terms of what, how to speak about particularly delicate topics, what to share, maybe even what not to share. There's some studies suggesting that, you know, maybe perfect transparency and perfect honesty maybe isn't the best answer because somebody might not be equipped to interpret it properly. So, I mean, there's just so many interesting topics. So I'll just sort of throw it to you for just that, maybe a general overview of what you think, or in the words of Chris McDonough, an overrun.
Let's not overrun it. Yeah, I mean, obviously, this is a very big field. There isn't an easy answer there, a very simple answer. We've definitely come a long way. We've definitely, I mean, there used to be a time when we weren't really thinking about medical ethics at all. It's just people were doing whatever they thought they wanted to. And especially with experiments, there wasn't an ethics board to say, no, you're not allowed to do that experiment because we think it's against human rights. So for sure, things have changed. Yeah, and I think it's, you know, you mentioned, I think you were talking about Hippocrates, just the old Greek dude. Of course, yeah. We know that the Hippocratic Oath is very, very old. It had some good things, and some things are quite not applicable to our society today. So actually, most medical schools don't use the Hippocratic Oath anymore, or they've made like a new version of it. And I think the most important part is just the respect of the patient, understanding that you need to respect the patient, respect their wishes. Consent is a very big concept these days.
And just obviously,
medicine and in society in general.
But I mean, if you know, the Hippocratic Oath certainly I would think is still applicable, just simply in the context of, you know, doing no harm, you know, or trying to think about it from a sort of a utilitarian consequentialist perspective.
I mean, yeah, that part is definitely still applicable, and it's sort of the basis of medicine. It's just that there are a lot more specific things about the Hippocratic Oath, you know, that aren't really working. But yeah, I mean, he did say don't sleep with your patients, so that's still applicable as well.
And I mean, that was
a good piece of advice.
I would say that's a good practice, to not sleep with your patients. The Gilbert Bystander, I have to share it because you and I have covered the topic so many times over the years. It's sort of a funny question. We've always addressed it in the context of psychology and moral philosophy, but I think, you know, there are some trolley problems and you know, moral paradoxes in medicine. That probably some prisoner dilemma issues. Any You want to make a joke on that or say something about that? I think it's funny.
Yeah, I don't really know what to say about this.
So let's see, you're driving an MRI machine, and on one track there are, you know, four people, and so you flip the switch and irradiate one patient to save four. I'm not sure how that would go.
Or just what's their life expectancy? Like, who are these people? Because if I'm going to save five 80-year-olds, maybe I would prefer to, you know, save one 10-year-old. You know, it's like, yep. I don't know. I don't want to touch this.
Well, now we're getting into Peter Singer territory.
Yeah.
You know, the hardcore moral philosophy.
Yeah, these are really, really, really complex questions.
Okay, so
I don't claim to have the answers to these things.
Since I brought up the topic of values, I believe you wanted me to potentially share another piece of media.
Yeah, I think
this is a good time.
That video is a great one. Yeah, that's a good time for it.
Now maybe, how the heck do I? Okay, get that up. Maybe we take a tiny break and see, are there any good questions out there before I play the video?
Yeah, sure.
Tell me if you see any. Dr. T, I almost said your name. Almost did it. Any other questions before we watch another video? I mean, I think we missed a few. I'm sure that we're good.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's hard to talk and keep your train of thought and then stop.
Oh, yeah. There's yeah. One. Somebody asked about the second booster. Yeah. Hi, Gilbert. I mean, so far it seems that we don't get sort of permanent immunity, if I can use that, with this particular vaccine. It is a type of immunity that we need to get boosters after an amount of time. And the question is, how much time do we need? And this information just keeps changing. We keep getting more and more facts about it, how long it lasts, against what strains. So obviously the third shot would be, depending on the current protocol, you know, some saying 6 months, usually it's around 6 months, and that depends also based on country, on region, on what strain you have there, and what type of vaccine you're using. Generally speaking, we know that we're going to be needing boosters, but for the exact amount of time you need, well, you're going to have to refer to your doctor for that decision.
Yeah, I mean, I think Diane's question here is definitely applicable and interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say it happens quite a bit. It's very common. And I would say usually you go with the Socratic method. You just go step by step and you explain to them exactly what it is that it's happening and where you are disagreeing with their assessment of the situation. You do need to, I don't want to say use your authority, but I want to say to be firm in your authority, to remind them that this is your specialty, this is the thing that you've been trained for. It doesn't make you automatically right, but it sort of helps in the conversation to not be too soft with people, because then they will just take as much space as you give them. So with these people who are very suspicious, you have to be firm, specific, give them the facts, listen to them, always listen to them, and explain to them exactly what it is that, exactly what it is that you're disagreeing with and why you think things are in a certain way.
Yeah, I mean, here's a million-dollar one that, on our scientific skepticism page, we deal with, constantly. I don't know how you would like to respond to that.
I mean, herd immunity is just a very important concept because it's the idea that if you have enough people that cannot contract a particular pathogen, that means that they're protecting the few members of their community that they are susceptible to them. So it's just this emergent phenomenon that it's very useful when you have a social creature that lives in big numbers.
Yeah, and I would like to weigh in on it too, because there's such a, I mean, because there's a lot of misinformation out there on this topic. I think there's also, a misunderstanding of the relevance of herd immunity. I mean, we live in a world, I mean, there are people for a long time, very smart people, who when they are looking at things like potential existential level threats to our species, pathogens, things like viruses, are really high up there. They're up there with things like nuclear war and, getting hit by a random meteor. And I think that what people don't understand is that, especially in the context of a novel virus, the relevance of that novel part is that it means it's new. It means that science does not necessarily have a lot of information on its nature and exactly what it can do and its rate of mutation and how it can mutate. And so when you're discussing herd immunity, you're talking about essentially the best means we know of to sort of stamp out a potential, I don't want to sound hyperbolic, but a potential, sort of species level extinction event, in the worst case scenario. So the idea of herd immunity is that if enough people are truly immune to a virus, you simply don't allow the virus any place to go, and you basically crowd it out of existence, and you prevent it from not only being able to propagate itself, but its ability to mutate. And so we may have a new virus that is not necessarily very dangerous in its current strain, but you don't know that two or three or four or five strains down the line, and we don't even know how long that can possibly take, can be something quite different. So when people are hesitant about things these days, I'm pretty sure that that hesitancy, that so-called skepticism, would dissipate fairly quickly if we started walking down the street and there were dead bodies strewn left and right. So, I mean, I do think it's important that people really understand that it's not necessarily an individual choice. It's really about us versus nature and us versus virology. So, I mean, I don't know how you feel about that, Dr. T, as a
Oh,
response.
very well said.
Thank you. I'm glad the doctor approves. So I think now maybe we'll show that little video clip. Yeah.
Yeah, sure, absolutely.
Okay, let me put that on.
Cole. He's my miracle child.
I'm sorry, Jen, if we made you sad. Yeah, I love this video. Maybe we should have been more, yeah, maybe we should have prepared you. But yeah, this is one of my favorite videos because it's just such a great reminder that every single person we meet, or we just come across, they have this whole world in their mind, they're themselves. They have so much going on. They have their fears and their thoughts and their hopes. So it's such a simple way to show that. And especially in healthcare, it's so beautiful to have this reminder. And just, it makes it so easy to be kind to others, I think. Makes it so easy to be kind.
Yeah. Empathy, baby.
Yeah, exactly.
So, okay, let's try to move on to some things. I'll try to move ahead. It's getting quite late for Dr. T in Greece. I think I'll try to cut short a few pieces this evening. Maybe we can meet up again and talk some more. But so maybe you can explain Laplace's demon for us and how it complements my brain in a vat.
Take
a shot at that one.
Yeah. So what Laplace said basically was, we can hypothesize a creature, a demon, that knew the position and the speed of every single particle that exists. And if that were the case, then that demon, that creature, would actually be able to predict and know what's going to happen next and what came before. So this is basically just the hard determinism.
And that not only would they know the position at a point in, at a reference point in terms of, you know, all of the matter in the universe, but they also would have be privy to and understand all of the laws of physics.
Yeah, absolutely. It's that sort of, yeah, the consequence of just knowing every single thing that exists.
Yeah, it's sort of the argument that omniscience would permit someone to predict the future. And obviously it's a long-standing and open debate about, as you said, certainly hard determinism. So I think both you and I probably, you know, we are certainly determinists to some extent, from soft determinism or from denial of determinism, or maybe not denial, but just we don't believe the universe is deterministic, to a very hard deterministic position where we do believe that it's just a gap in our ignorance which needs to be filled in order for us to know how it all plays out. And I think that this idea is very controversial because I think it scares people that if hard determinism were true, that somehow our freedom, our independence, our free will, you know, we can talk about that another topic, is in question, and that we're sort of nothing but a automaton just sort of bumbling through the universe as a function of the laws of physics.
Absolutely.
And then how do you think, why don't you explain a bit why we chose it and how it sort of complements my brain of that.
Yeah, well, both of those things, I think it's more like a wink at philosophy in general, at, well, you say a lot, epistemic humility, just accepting that there is a lot that we can't be sure. And we want to think about things and keep an open mind about them. I feel like it's more tongue in cheek than actually us prescribing to these ideas per se.
Yeah, correct. Because I mean, as I even said in my introduction video, it is absolutely a nod to a particular school of skepticism called philosophical skepticism or Cartesian skepticism, which is a bit too esoteric, even a bit too far for me, but it's still useful to keep us honest and to accept and recognize our ignorance and our, you know, our lack of epistemic access, our ability to know certain things, at least at this point. So it's really just a nod to the value of humility. It doesn't necessarily mean that we subscribe to these schools of thought.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
So I know that it's getting late, so maybe we'll stop and take a few questions, keep you for a little bit later, and then I think I will sum it up and say good night. So does anybody have some questions for Dr. T while she's still awake? I think she's on her last leg here at this point. What time is it there, so everybody knows?
It's almost 3 a.m.
Right. So any questions for Dr. T before we let her go get some rest? Oh, I did, maybe before we end it on your part, there was an original question about why psychiatry. And maybe we want to deal with that one before. And basically, you know, there's a longstanding joke, which, you know, maybe you've heard of somewhere once upon a time, that, you know, the only reason people really go into psychology and psychiatry is not necessarily to help other people, but rather because they want to figure out what's going on in their brain and figure out how they think. So what is your response to that longstanding joke?
Yeah. I find it interesting that it's considered a bad thing just for psychiatry and psychology. So it's like an electrician becoming an electrician because, you know, they want to fix their lights at home, nobody would consider that a bad thing. So, you know, your personal experience makes you interested in a field and you pursue it professionally. In any other field, nobody would even, you know, they wouldn't even spend any time talking about it. So I'm a little bit confused about why it's used as something negative. As for why I chose psychiatry, I mean, I guess there's something similar in terms of, I don't remember a particular moment where I chose it. It was just happening. I often say it calls me. I feel like it selected me more than I selected it. I always found the human mind fascinating. Just understanding how people think, how people feel, what makes for this experience. And then, of course, what makes it a bad experience. And then wanting to fix that. Again, going back to fixing things. So it's been such a simple thing then to end up wanting to go into the field of mind, the medicine of the mind. I guess it's another way of saying it.
Absolutely. I mean, I don't think there's too many more interesting things in the universe than mind, depending upon how you understand it. And I'm pretty sure that we all want to understand how the mind works, how we can maybe fix minds that are having some issues, and how to possibly improve our own mind and be our better, healthier selves, right?
Absolutely.
So I think poor Dr. T is really going past her bedtime. Do you want to maybe stay a couple minutes and we'll just see if there are any sort of final questions, and then I'll let you go and I'll wrap up on my own?
Yeah, sure.
So a couple minutes, guys. Anything that you would like to ask? We have to wait because there's a bit of a time lag. Oh, we didn't show the Mitchell and Webb video.
Yeah, but I mean, it's okay, because if we're going to have this conversation and continue it, we want to talk about, you know, okay, things like alternative medicine and all that. I think we should give them their time.
Okay, so then you'd like to maybe do this again?
Yeah, of course.
Okay, sounds good.
If people wanted to.
Oh, right, exactly. Would you like Dr. T to come back a second time if you enjoyed her and learned anything? Throw one up on the screen. There's some more.
Thank you so much for the nice comments, everybody.
Thanks, Jen. I hope you liked it. I've been wanting to get Laplace's demon up here so that you guys would all get to meet her and for her to impart some of her knowledge on us. And, you know, hopefully you find it beneficial and value added. And, you know, and we will look forward to being able to do it again and talk about a lot of other, hopefully, valuable topics related to medicine, and a whole host of other topics too, because she, as I told you, is not unidimensional at all. She is my intellectual equal in all topics across the board.
Least three dimensions, damn it.
At least three dimensions. Well, I think you're like the string. You're like the string theory of persons. So you have probably, you know, 10 spatial dimensions as well as a time dimension. And your
too much for my brain.
And your time dimension, exactly. Your time dimension is so at its limits that I shouldn't have even gone down that rabbit hole with you, because now I'm just going to traumatize you. So I think everyone, we're going to let Dr. T go to bed. Any last words, Dr. T?
So yeah, it's been very nice. It's been fun being here and having this conversation with you. It's been a wonderful community here that you've built. I appreciate all the people that came here and asked their questions. And I'm sorry if we missed some. It's hard to talk and read at the same time. But yeah, I look forward to doing this again.
Okay, then. On that note, you go get some sleep, young lady. We need you fit and of sound mind. So. Good night. Thank you so much for coming.
Bye-bye.
Okay, so I will remain here Maybe we can talk a little bit. I wanted to bring Dr. T, aka Laplace's demon, on this evening for a couple reasons. Obviously, I'd like you to meet her. And, you know, I would like to, you know, she's essentially the second part, the second contributor to the Scientific Skeptic channel. She's an integral, I don't like that word, that's hard to say, part of the, you know, project that I've been working on for the last 10 years, and my website, and all of our work. And so I happen to have sort of branched off because of this whole true crime thing. But the second reason that I wanted, and so, you know, I certainly look forward to bringing her back up, and hopefully we can talk about all sorts of interesting other topics. But I also wanted to bring her up, you know, for a couple of reasons. I wanted to bring her up in the context of sort of professionalism and to discuss things like ethics. And I wanted to bring it into the context of some of our true crime community issues that we've been talking about ad nauseum. You know, I think we all share certain concerns about irresponsible behavior, sort of lack of competence, sort of lack of prerequisite skills, things like, you know, I've been thinking about making a parody about something like I think I even made a community post about the concept of sort of a job interview parody where, you know, YouTube is hiring, you know, potential true crime content creators. And so, you know, the parody is sort of the concept of an interview, like a regular interview, where we would be taking resumes. And if you can imagine sort of the parody of an interview with somebody who's a budding true crime content creator and wants to start a YouTube channel, you know, what are the sorts of qualifications that we might ask? And, you know, could you have maybe at least a background a little bit in journalistic ethics in terms of how to report delicate information? Should you possibly have a bit of a background in investigative ethics, how to possibly question somebody who might have information on a case if you're going to bring them up on a panel, for example, or establish a relationship with them in an ongoing case? Should you have a rudimentary background in law? Should you have a rudimentary background in critical thinking, in logic? Are these skills necessary to treat a delicate and complex topic like true crime properly and adequately and responsibly? So I wanted to bring Dr. T up to sort of show, you know, what it takes to be a good doctor. And that's just one profession. What does it take to be a, you know, the best mechanic in the world, or a really good engineer, or any host of other professions? And if true crime content creator is to now be a sort of profession in this new post-truth era, this runaway relativism, this revenge of the layperson, shouldn't we have standards? Shouldn't we require certain prerequisites? And if we don't value professionalism and education and some sort of prerequisite skills in this space, then is that not the same thing as saying we should let taxi drivers, you know, perform root canals? Does it mean that brain surgeons should be able to fly jumbo jets? And does it mean that pilots of jumbo jets should be given access to a scalpel to remove tumors in a patient who may not live unless their brain tumor is removed successfully. So I wanted to just bring up the topic in this context of sort of the post-truth era, where it seems as though opinion has been elevated to the position of knowledge, or dare I say, truth. So I just wanted to give you, you know, hopefully an expert, a professional, someone who has worked her butt off for more than a decade, and, you know, sort of that has well-calibrated ethics that I think are worthy of the importance of such a profession, like saving lives. In the crime world, there are a lot of life and death dynamics which are similar to medicine. And if an investigator or a journalist or a YouTube content creator or a lawyer or a judge doesn't do his or her job well, or doesn't take it seriously, or doesn't have the competence, it can be the difference between life and death. So that's sort of how I wanted to bring it back to how the relevance to sort of the other, you know, topic that we've been discussing, and the reason why I came to YouTube. So I think I will end it there. I'll hang around for a few minutes for questions. I hope that makes sense, sort of how I tried to tie the relevance of Dr. T's account and how it might be relevant to us in other ways. Thank you, Gigi. The same to you. Absolutely. And thank you so much, Pixie. That's really generous of you. I appreciate that. So, a question. What can we as individuals do to call to account the shameful, unethical speculation of creators with a large number of followers? That really is the million-dollar question. I think it takes a village, so I think we need to demand it, first of all. I think we need some help from some big guns. I had a long conversation with Trisha from Web Sleuth today to address this very topic, and it's something that I've been proposing for a while. I'm going to talk with a few other larger creators. You know, one of the problems is, and I please don't take this as a boast, but I'm a bit of a player in a different community, in the scientific skeptic community on Facebook. I have a large community. I have 127,000 followers, and I'm sort of jacked into the network if I need to be. So if I wanted to mobilize a large group of people in my community, I could do it fairly easily, because I sort of know most of the big players in that space, and I have a bit of clout. And I used to be a big part of that community, and a lot of the bigger players than I am today were my original subscribers 10 years ago, and they went on to take the baton and create an even bigger community. So I have a bit of power, for lack of a better word, in that community, but I don't have that power here because I'm a no-name, insignificant YouTuber. But there are some big players that have taken notice. I think possibly we have all made a bit of an impact, because I think we're all becoming increasingly aware that there are some consequences from that problem. And so I am going to try to have a bit of impact to the extent that I can. Hopefully, you know, we can maybe sort of work together, all of us, all of you, and maybe get some bigger guns into this space to at least put pressure on, you know, my bad actors, and to, you know, so that people know that there are others who are watching, and that there will be consequences, and that if they want to stay in this space and contribute, that they're going to have to learn better rules and be more responsible. Because we can't just shut them down. This is a free society. YouTube clearly doesn't seem to be taking a strong position from an oversight and ethical perspective. Chris McDonough was reinstated. I formally asserted that I think that's a mistake in my apology, my demand for an apology video. And so YouTube's not going to do anything. I would never condemn real life consequences. So I would condemn anyone that went after any of these people in real life, tried to destroy their, jobs or dox them. You know, I use words, I use arguments. That's all I'm willing to do. And to the extent that reason and evidence are not effective, then we don't have much left except making people pay social consequences. And on that front, although it's not my normal instinct to be too into shaming people or ridiculing people, we are a social animal. Social animals don't like being shunned. They don't like being ostracized. They don't like being ridiculed. So if a problem becomes consequential, there aren't too many avenues after reason. You know, in the words of Sam Harris, we have conversation and then we have violence. Well, I don't condemn violence. I certainly don't condemn breaking the law. And I don't condemn going real life on people. So, reason and evidence are my primary tools, but my emergency tool, and I think it's a valid tool, is making people pay social consequences. So that would be my answer to that rather complex question. Yeah, Ozzy, what they're doing is so immoral and wrong in my book. This excuse, this pathetic effort to justify that behavior by basically lying that they have some positive contribution to make by putting pressure on the authorities and individuals that are withholding information. Don't buy that. This is about self-promotion. It's opportunism. It's about growing their social media presence, producing sensational content and economic. So unless you guys have a few more good questions, I think I'll be winding us down, maybe a few more minutes, and then I will say goodnight. And before I say my final goodnight, thank you everyone for coming. Thank you for all the great questions. Thank for showing respect to Dr. T and getting along. Thank you again to all the mods and all of their generous volunteer time. I can never thank you enough. Anyone who contributed anything, I'm flattered. I appreciate it. If you think I provide any value in this space and you want to help, it's greatly appreciated. So I would like to wish you all a lovely holiday, Merry Christmas, any of the other various ways of celebrating during this vacation, as well as a Happy New Year if we don't speak in advance. And yeah, have fun, celebrate, take a breath from the complexity of life these days and the, and job stress and life stress. So eat, be merry, love, have a good time. I wish that for all of you. And I will be having fun with my cats, and I will be probably splurging on some sort of adult cocktail. But I did have a very positive conversation with Trisha today. She's quite motivated, and I am motivated as well. So I think I will leave you on that rather encouraging and positive note. We have some reason warriors here, and a lot of you are reason warriors. So keep up the good fight. And on that note, I think I will bid you adieu. Je vous souhaite à toutes et à tous une bonne soirée et jusqu'à la prochaine fois. Ciao, mes copains.